Thank you, Greg, for your kind introduction. Madame and Messieurs, friends and colleagues, thank you for attending this first lecture of this very special 70th Canadian Geotechnical Society Conference and the 12th Joint IAH Conference. I would like to thank Mamadou and the organizing committee for selecting me to give this hearty address. Robert MacDonald Hardy was an iconic leader of our Canadian geotechnical fraternity. To give this lecture that was established to recognize his accomplishments is a great honor. When I was invited by the organizing committee to give this lecture, they also asked me, as Mamadou mentioned, for a list of possible topics, which I was pleased to do. And from this list, they selected the topic with the title shown here. I was pleased with their choice because it combines two important issues: the design of mechanically stabilized earth walls and emerging developments regarding reliability-based design of soil structures. The challenge for me, however, is to present the topic in an easy to understandable manner, and I hope I'm up to that challenge. Let me begin by reminding you that mechanically stabilized earth, or MSE walls, are a mature and proven technology. Reinforced soil walls with steel strips gained traction in the 1970s. They are now ubiquitous on the geotechnical engineering landscape to perform the earth retaining wall function. With the advent of high-performance polymeric geotextiles and geogrids, variations on the MSC wall theme emerged rapidly. Here is a slide of historical interest showing the first wrapped face wall constructed in North America. The essential reinforcement geometry is shown here, and it's quite clear why we call these wrapped faced walls. Of course, substantially larger and higher structures have been constructed since, including this wall that was constructed in Seattle to support the sides of a very large preload embankment. The geotechnical engineer now has available many different soil reinforcement options for mechanically stabilized earth walls, and here's just one example using polyester strap soil reinforcement. MSC walls constructed with modular block facings in combination with geotextiles and geogrids are now common. Regardless of the facing type, the objective is to create a composite soil gravity block with sufficient mass and coherence to resist the destabilizing forces due to a body of retained soil. Can you see my mouse? This is the first substantial modular block wall constructed in Canada almost 30 years ago, and I'm sort of bragging and showing my age at the same time. Here's a variation on the same theme, with the modular block facings being swapped out from geosynthetic reinforcement sheets to steel ladder type. MSC walls have been constructed with welded wire forms or baskets to form the facing. They have been used to support the footings at the end of bridge decks as an alternative to piling. So, what is the motivation for my presentation? The design of geotechnical soil structures is moving towards performance-based design expressed in a reliability theory-based framework. This means that margins of safety for limit states are computed in terms of probabilities of acceptable behavior. This is a complementary approach to the classical factor of safety method used by geotechnical engineers, and which we are all familiar with. A subset of this approach is load and resistance factor design, LRFD, which has been used by structural engineers for decades. Geotechnical engineers have been slower to embrace LRFD for geotechnical foundations and earth retaining structures. As a result, they are less familiar with methods to arrive at load and resistance factors, i.e. LRFD calibration, and perhaps structural engineers are equally uncomfortable as well. Formal LRFD calibration for internal limit states of MSC walls is in its infancy. Reliability-based design and LRFD calibration for MSC walls is challenged by issues related to the accuracy of the underlying load and resistance models that are available today and typically have a very high empirical content. In Canada, LRFD calibration must be consistent with notions of level of understanding that now appear in the Canadian Highway Bridge Design Code and have been adopted to reward engineers for using better models and greater site project information. Rigorous LRFD calibration follows from concepts of reliability-based analysis and design. Let's consider as an example the classical sliding block limit state problem. The retaining structure in this example is conveniently an MSC wall with the reinforcement layers creating a composite gravity block. The block is acted on by a load from the retained soil, the magnitude of which can be computed using classical earth pressure theory. The resistance to sliding is due to shear strength available at the base of the block, as shown here. The limit state function or performance function for this mechanism is shown by the equation G. And here, F can be understood to be the familiar factor of safety against sliding. If G is greater than zero, the block is safe. If G is less than zero, then sliding failure occurs, which is unacceptable. Let's explode the driving force equation to expose sources of uncertainty in our estimate of the destabilizing load Q. There are uncertainties in the magnitude of the peak friction angle, the unit weight of the soil. The same is true of the choice of friction angle and unit weight for the reinforced soil sliding boundary. This scheme is admittedly a simple interpretation of the sliding limit state because we are assuming all other parameters are deterministic. Let's plot computed values of nominal resistance and nominal load on a simple linear plot with the diagonal line shown here, denoting the boundary between acceptable and unacceptable combinations of nominal resistance and nominal load. Let's select possible combinations of soil strength and unit weight for the nominal resistance term and the nominal load term. And you can see these points that I'm taking off these distributions for friction angle and load. And the result here is the blue symbol, which represents an acceptable outcome because it's falling above the diagonal line. Let's repeat the exercise with other combinations. And the red dot signifies that in this case, the outcome is not satisfactory. Let's repeat the calculation with other random combinations of soil values. And in this example, by counting the number of instances of G that are less than zero by the total number of trials, we may end up with a probability of failure of 50%. This is clearly unsatisfactory. What can we do to fix the problem? Well, we just make the gravity block longer. And if we do this, the result is the data points move up and the probability of failure decreases to 5% in this case. But is this enough? Well, I think we understand what the notion of probability of failure is. It's fairly straightforward. But we hear the term reliability index, when we talk about limit states design, and what is the relationship between reliability index and probability of failure. Let's plot on the right-hand side of this slide the distribution of G values that were generated in the previous example. And let's plot them as a frequency distribution curve. The red area under this curve that falls to the left of G equals zero is the probability of failure. The reliability index beta is the number of standard deviations between G equals zero and the mean of the distribution. As we increase the number of instances of safe design, then the distribution of G values shifts to the right, and the probability of failure decreases as the reliability index increases. In fact, there is a simple approximation for the probability of failure expressed by, as a function of the reliability index, and it's called the standard normal cumulative distribution function, and you can find it in your Excel spreadsheet. This plot on the left-hand side shows the values of reliability index and probability of failure that may be acceptable for external modes of failure for a gravity wall structure, such as base sliding. So depending on the regulator and the code, values of 1 in 1,000 or perhaps as low as 1 in 5,000 may be acceptable. And there's a corresponding reliability index value matching those two probabilities of failure. The actual values, as I mentioned, are determined by regulators and code writers. For the internal stability limit states for MSC walls, the probabilities of failure of 1 in 100 are acceptable. And this is because these systems are highly strength redundant. If one layer fails due to rupture or pullout, then the load is shed to its neighbor and the system remains intact. So what is the connection between probability of failure or reliability index and the resistance factor and the load factor that appear in a simple limit state design equation such as the one that's shown at the top of the slide? The load factor multiplies the nominal load and the resistance factor multiplies the nominal resistance. The expectation in LRFD design codes is that the resistance factor will be one or less, and the load factor will be one or greater. Satisfying this factored limit state equation forces the engineer to select a larger nominal resistance and or a lower nominal load during design. This forces the distribution for G to shift to the right. And in doing so, we end up with a bigger beta and a smaller probability of failure. Now, if we rearrange this simple limit state design equation, then the ratio of nominal resistance and nominal load must be at least equal to or greater than the ratio of the load and resistance factor. Typical values for internal limit states for MSC walls are 1.35 for the load factor and 0.9 for the resistance factor. And this ratio is conveniently equal to the factor of safety of 1.5, which is a common value that we see in geotechnical soil structure limit states. And in fact, mapping and relating the ratio of load to resistance factor to factor of safety is called calibration to past practice. But it doesn't guarantee that the corresponding target probability of failure or reliability index is reasonable. Rigorous LRFD calibration involves finding values for load factor and resistance factor such that if the limit state design function is just satisfied, then the probability of failure PF is less than some acceptable value, or equivalently, the reliability index beta is greater than a target value, so that we fall within the green zone that you see on this plot. Let's now return to the sliding block example. Recall that we must have some uncertainty in the estimate of soil unit weight and friction angle. Therefore, we can expect some uncertainty in the estimate of nominal load and nominal resistance at time of design. And so I've replotted the distributions of nominal load and resistance by these idealized distributions that you see on the figure. And then I've reproduced them again here. Now, regardless of the type of distribution of nominal load and nominal resistance, I can compute a mean value and a coefficient of variation for these values. For the purpose of this example, I can assume that the mean values are my best estimates of the nominal values that I would use for design. If I assume that the distribution of nominal resistance and nominal load are log normal distributed, then a very neat and convenient equation can be used to link the reliability index beta to the mean and COV of these distributions, as shown here. Note that the ratio of best estimate of nominal resistance and nominal load is the classical factor of safety that we identified earlier. Recall that the ratio of nominal resistance to nominal load cannot be less than the ratio of load factor to resistance factor, and hence we can replace the factor of safety by this ratio. Rearranging this equation allows us to isolate the resistance factor as shown in the bottom equation. Knowing the COV of the nominal values and adopting a target beta value means that the only parameter I don't have in hand to compute the resistance factor is the load factor gamma. How can we get this value? To demonstrate how this is done, let's consider the rupture and pullout internal limit states for MSC walls. Here, Q is the nominal load. It's the maximum tensile load in the reinforcement. And the resistance terms are computed as shown by two equations here. This is the top equation for rupture, the second equation for pullout. And let's expand the load equation, which shows that the maximum load is computed using classical earth pressure theory. You can see the value of K in this expression. To find the load factor, gamma, we need a database of paired, predicted, and measured loads under operational conditions. This is the LRFD calibration procedure. How do we do this? Well, we collect measured load data from carefully instrumented structures. And this has been a major effort by myself and my colleagues over the last two decades, collecting this data. From these data, we can compute load bias values, which are the ratio of tensile or measured tensile load to predicted load. And for each measured load value, which we can gather from strain gauges attached to the reinforcing elements. So for each one of these load values that we've measured in the field, we can compute the matching predicted or calculated value using one of a number of different load models. An example load model is the ASHDO simplified method, which has a large empirical component. For a particular reinforcement type, for example, a steel strip, and the reinforcement's location, I can pick off the appropriate equivalent earth pressure, K. Put this into the equation for load and compute the predicted load value, which is the nominal load that one would use in design. From the paired data, we can plot a cumulative distribution plot of load bias values as shown here, and examine probabilities that predicted values will be exceeded under typical operating conditions. So ASHDO and the Canadian Highway Bridge Design Code originally used a 3% load exceedance value to select gamma. Hence, for the strip steel data that you see here, there is a 3% chance that measured loads will be 1.6 times the predicted values. For the steel grid data, There is a 3% chance that the measured loads will be 1.47 times the predicted values. The typical dead load factor using ASHTO is 1.35. If we accept this value, then the exceedance value is actually 14% for both steel reinforcement data, and clearly that's greater than 3%. So there's some important lessons here and challenges, and that is, for a fixed load exceedance criterion, different load models may give different load factors. Or for a fixed load factor, different load models may give different exceedance factors. This is a situation that structural engineers do not typically worry about. A dead load is a dead load. For internal limit states for LRFD calibration, however, the load factor will vary with the load model that you use. And there are lots of models to choose from. So now we have all the ingredients to compute the resistance factor. Assuming a target beta value given to us by regulators, we can now have load and resistance factors for our simple limit state equation, as you've seen in the bottom equation here. And we may end up with values of, say, 0.9 for the resistance factor and 1.35 for the load factor. But so far, we have assumed that the load and resistance models are perfect. There's no error. We assume that all uncertainty is due to choice of the nominal input values at time of design. However, there are other sources of uncertainty at time of design. And we can explore this issue further by using the concept of level of understanding that has been recently adopted in the Canadian Highway Bridge Design Code. In this approach, when we use a limit state equation, we can expect to have a range of confidence in its applicability to our project-specific conditions. This confidence ranges from low to high. If we have limited or poor geotechnical data for our project, or perhaps we have little experience with the technology or the model that we're using, this would correspond to low level of understanding. At the opposite end of the scale is high understanding. A geotechnical engineer can move from low understanding to high understanding by, for example, carrying out more detailed site investigation or carrying out more soil testing. In this case, the engineer and her or his client is rewarded by being able to use a larger resistance factor in the limit state equation. And I'd like to give a shout out to my good friend Gordon Fenton for introducing this concept of level understanding to the foundations section of the Canadian Highway Bridge Design Code. And it's this idea that's been incorporated in our calibration exercises. Now, this approach requires self-evaluation. So there is an element of engineering judgment in the use of this method, which is a good thing. And here is an example template for determining level of understanding for the pullout limit state that we have discussed earlier. It looks at the experience of the designer. It looks at the amount of materials testing and information of that type. And it looks at the project complexity. And from these combinations of information, we can select our level of understanding. And the Canadian Highway Bridge Design Code requires that you must demonstrate high level of understanding before you can assign this advantage to your design calculation. So you can't all just say, oh, I have high level of understanding. You have to prove that you have gone the extra mile to put yourself in that category. Now, in order to implement the concept of the level of understanding in a quantitative way, in other words, put it into the formulations that I've shown before, we need to assign to each of those levels of understanding a quantitative estimate of uncertainty to these three levels. And a review of the literature suggests that high understanding corresponds to a coefficient of variation on our estimate of nominal values of 0.1. Typical understanding is about 20%, and low understanding is about 30%. Hence, I can take those quantitative values and I can put them into this mother equation that I've shown before, and I can calculate for each level of understanding a corresponding resistance factor, and this resistance factor will increase as my level of understanding improves. So, we assume that the load and resistance models are perfect. We've assumed that all uncertainty is due to choice of nominal input values at time of design. However, there are other sources of uncertainty at the time of design that we haven't addressed at this moment. And in fact, this is the error that is associated with the deterministic models that appear in our limit state design equations. And again, this is a particular concern for internal stability limit states for MSC walls, because almost all load and resistance models in MSC wall design, internal design, have a large empirical component. There are also lots of models to choose from. In one case, we looked at something like 15 different models for the calculation of pullout capacity. And all of these models have varying accuracy. And this model error, in fact, can influence true margins of safety more than the choice of nominal input values at the time of design. Now, fortunately, there's a good side story to this issue with respect to MSC walls, and that is there's enough data available to quantify model error for internal limit states for MSC walls. And this data applies to the ultimate tensile rupture limit state and pullout for MSC walls constructed both with geosynthetic extensible reinforcement and also inextensible and steel soil reinforcement. How can we quantify this error? Well, we've already touched on one example where we use load bias data to compute the load factor. Let's use the same data now to examine model accuracy. Now recall that load bias is the ratio of measured load to predicted load, as shown in the formula at the top left. To predict, so we can gather information on measured load data, and we can pair it up with predicted load, as I described earlier. But now what I'm going to do is I'm going to plot this data on this plot that you see here, measured load versus calculated load. And I'm going to use log scales so that the data points are not crowded into the lower corner of this plot. Now, if the model was perfect, the data would plot along a one-to-one diagonal line shown here. And typical of geotechnical soil structure problems, this is unlikely. And the weight of the data points falls above the one-to-one line, as you can see here. For example, a calculated load using this model 1, I'm not going to tell you which model it is, of 10 kilonewtons per meter would give you, on average, a corresponding predicted load of 13.6 kilonewtons per meter. So this corresponds to a bias mean of 1.36, which is a non-conservative outcome for design. The model also has error as quantified by the spread in bias values, which corresponds to a coefficient of variation of 50% in this example. And this would be considered a poor model. Here is an example of a relatively good load model. We're using the same measured data as in the previous example, but we're using a better model, Model 2. Now, mean bias value now is almost 1. You can see that the weight of the data is falling very close to the one-to-one correspondence line, and the spread is less. It's now only about 35%. Okay, we've explored load model accuracy and load bias values. Let's now look at the resistance side of our limit state design equation. So we could look at, in this case, let's look at pullout. We need to generate bias data as before, where pullout bias is the ratio of measured pullout capacity, Rm, to predicted or nominal value, Rn. So how do we get these values? Well, we have to carry out laboratory pullout tests using some standard test protocol that we all agree on. And here you see an example in schematic form of a conventional pullout box. And we can take samples of our reinforcement and test them under different confining pressures. And for each test, we can gather a measured pullout capacity value, and we can compare that to the predicted value using the pullout model of interest, which is shown on the bottom of this slide. Here, we plotted the measured pullout values against the predicted values. And this is using a well-known model X that's found in the literature. In this case, the mean value of bias is 1.18, which means that the model is conservative for design, since the measured value is about 18% higher than the predicted values on average. Here is the same measured pullout data, but using a different pullout model. This model is more accurate on average. You can see the mean bias is close to 1, and the spread in terms of COV is only 13%. Let's assume for a moment that the only uncertainty is the limits in the limit state design function are the models. We have bias statistics describing that uncertainty for load and resistance terms. Load on the left, resistance on the right. Beta can be now computed using the same form of equation we saw earlier for the case of uncertainty only in the nominal load values. Rearranging to isolate theta, we have the following equation. And again, it looks familiar in form to the equation that we saw earlier. We can now, having the load factor and a target beta, we can then calculate the resistance factor. And this equation, in fact, is the recommended procedure adopted in the United States currently. But it's based only on model accuracy. So now we've seen the case for uncertainty only in the choice of nominal values earlier in the presentation. Okay, so we've seen these before. Let's combine them with uncertainty and the equations in the limit state design functions based on error in the models only. Now our equations for beta and resistance factor consider both the uncertainty in the models and the uncertainty in choice of nominal values. So here the green highlight are the nominal values, the blue highlighted values are the statistics for the bias values, the accuracy of our models. And let me now demonstrate how we can use this combined formulation to compute theta for the case using our favorite limit state equation at the top of the slide. From the beta formulation, we can rearrange our equation to give theta, and with gamma, the load factor, and a target beta value, I can now generate a suite of resistance factors for each combination of load and resistance model used in my limit state design function that also considers project-specific level of understanding. So, I can introduce the matching COVs of nominal loads, where the level of understanding increases as the COV values go down, and for each level of understanding, for each model, I can calculate a resistance factor, and this resistance factor will increase with improved level of understanding, and so the method preserves the intent of the current edition of the Canadian Highway Bridge Design Code. And the result is plots of this type. So for different load factors, different levels of understanding, different targets of probability of failure or reliability index, one can generate these plots, and they're very easy to generate because they're generated from a closed form solution. So there's no requirement to do Monte Carlo simulation. The results of these calculations are transparent because the formulations make this transparent, easy to detect. So the conclusions and impact from what I have spoken to you today is that we now have a framework for both reliability-based design and LRFD calibration for simple soil structure limit states. They consider uncertainty in the selection of nominal values, and they link, the framework links uncertainty in selection of nominal values to concepts of level understanding, which has been recently adopted by the Canadian Highway Bridge Design Code. It considers the accuracy of the underlying models used in the limit state equation, which is independent of project conditions. And the general approach has been demonstrated for the case of internal limit states for MSC walls. And the approach is general. It can be used for other systems. And in fact, we have carried out similar LRFD calibration exercises for other systems, like, for example, soil nails or walls constructed with anchors and such. So the approach is perfectly general. So I'd like to conclude my talk by acknowledging my collaborators. Behind every professor, there are colleagues and postdocs, PhDs, and I have had a large number, but the persons that have been particularly helpful in the development of the work that I've described to you today are shown in this slide here. And without their help, none of this would have been possible. So thank you for your attention. Merci.
Mr. President, honored guests, ladies and gentlemen. I am Michael Mozesek, a retired research officer from the Division of Building Research of the National Research Council, also a past president of CGS, a past president of the Canadian Foundation for Geotechnique, and a past executive director of the Engineering Institute of Canada. As a rookie researcher early in my career, I received very sound advice from Dr. R.F. Leggett, the director of the Division of Building Research. He told me that my research was very good, which must be made available to the technical profession or it will be of little value. It has to be reported and has to be published and has to be presented at meetings and conferences and so on. Dr. Bathurst,
I'm here.
There you are. Your research work is very good. You have published widely and have made numerous presentations at conferences, meetings in Canada and worldwide. You incorporated an important concept in the level of understanding in the Canadian Highway Bridge Design Code and the National Building Code of Canada. We are proud of our Canadian ambassador, for the Canadian Geotechnical Society. On behalf of our members, it is my great pleasure to thank you and to present the certificate from the Canadian Geotechnical Society for your excellent R.M. Hardy address. Dr. Bathurst.
Thanks, Mike. Thank you. Smile at the camera.